nanohub.org.
Online simulation and more for nanotechnology.
Welcome to this short introduction to the concept of P-bits, which we view as a very nice conceptual way of thinking about this building block for probabilistic logic. Now, in digital electronics, we are all familiar with the concept of bits. We represent information as 0 and 1. And one way of physically representing it is in terms of stable magnets, because magnets have two stable states, the easy axis and the one exactly opposite. And you could represent one as 0, and the other could represent 1. Now, at the other end of things is this field of quantum computing, where the basic unit is this qubits, which are this delicate superposition of spins of 0 and 1. Now, magnets are also built out of spins. It's just that lots of spins, due to their internal interaction, point in one direction or the other. That is, usually you have an easy axis, and the low energy state is one where all spins point in that direction. And if all of them point in the opposite direction, then that's the other stable state. And usually if you put the magnet in one of these states, it stays there for a very long time. Why? Because there's a big barrier in between, which separates it from the other stable possibility. And if you want the information to stay there for, say, 10 years, then usually you'd have to make this barrier like 50 times the thermal energy, the KT. Now, a well-known problem with small magnets is that when you make them small, often the barrier is not big enough. And so if you put it in one of these stable states, it wants to go over to the other one and back. And it will go back and forth in like milliseconds or microseconds or even nanoseconds, depending on the height of this barrier. And this is a well-known problem with nanomagnets. And what we have been arguing is that, well, that's really an opportunity, because these unstable magnets provide a very natural physical representation for what we call P-bits. So what are the P-bits? Well, they're very classical things, nothing quantum about it. It just fluctuates back and forth between the zero state and the one state. They're not superpositions like the qubits. They're either 0 or 1. It's just that they fluctuate back and forth between them. And so these P-bits represent something intermediate between the stable bits of digital electronics and the qubits of quantum computing. And it's an open question that what kind of functionalities, what kind of applications could you address using circuits made out of P-bits as opposed to circuits made out of qubits? That's an, as I said, an open question with many facets to it. But what is clear is that these P-bits, though, actually map nicely into another field, namely that of neural networks. Actually, it maps to a kind of subset of that neural network, of that field, which you could call the stochastic neural networks. If you Google the word neural networks, you'd usually see a picture something like this. There would be a threshold element, or the neuron, you know, one where, depending on the input, it goes from one stable value to another. And the input to these neurons are derived from the synapse, which sums up, which makes, I guess, gets a weighted sum of the outputs of many other neurons. Now, for stochastic neural networks, the neuron itself is replaced by this binary stochastic neuron, which is kind of like that. But what happens is, if the input is very much to the left, you get one stable state. If it's very much to the right, you get the other stable state. But in between, it fluctuates back and forth between the two stable states. So here, in the middle, this is 0, whereas here, in the middle, it's plus 1 and minus 1 with equal probability, so that the average is 0. And if you go over a little bit to the right, it's still fluctuating, but it's plus 1 a little more of the time than it is minus 1. And so the average is positive, but not 1 yet. Okay. And mathematically, something like this, this binary stochastic neuron, could be described with an equation of this form. And these two equations are widely used for discussing these stochastic neural networks in terms of software descriptions. On the other hand, what we are arguing is that these unstable magnets actually give you a natural way of physically implementing this relation. Of course, when you implement it in software, these M and I are just numbers, dimensionless numbers. Whereas when you actually build hardware circuits out of it, they represent voltages in a circuit, you know, stochastic voltages. Now, what we are very excited about is something we did last year, something we showed last year, is that a standard device in MRAM technology, I mean, that's a upcoming technology, which involves a transistor with a magnetic tunnel junction. So this is a standard device that people are building now in this technology. And what we showed was that if you replaced that MTJ, the magnetic tunnel junction, with a bad MTJ, you know, bad meaning the one where this free layer, which is supposed to be a stable magnet, is actually an unstable magnet, then the resulting unit would actually give you a relation between input and output exactly like what we want for the binary stochastic neuron. And this device then, it means, is like, it's already an existing device, so a whole new device doesn't need to be built. But it's just that we want the bad ones, or you deliberately make the magnets unstable. And then you'd have a three-terminal unit that you could use to build large circuits, just like the circuits of digital electronics, which are built out of lots of transistors. But you could use this as the building block for these P circuits. And, of course, what that unit gives you, what this unit gives you, is the neuron, the P bit, the binary stochastic neuron. You still need the synapse. And there we have many possibilities. You could use a resistive network or a capacitive network, or you could implement it in software. There are many possibilities there. But once you combine that with the neuron, you could address many interesting applications. And roughly speaking, the idea is this, that in standard digital electronics, the node voltages represent deterministic quantities, which are 0 or 1. Whereas in a probabilistic circuit, they would be fluctuating between the two with different probabilities. And so such P circuits give you a natural way of addressing problems where the variables are probabilistic. And in a sequence of papers, we have shown that you could use it to build Bayesian circuits and image recognition problems, to address optimization problems, or even machine learning. And interestingly, we even showed that these could be used to build Boolean circuits, you know, which are normally built using digital electronics. Now, you might say, well, why would you want to do that, because that's done with deterministic circuits quite well. And the interesting point is that if you build it out of P circuits, then they work in an invertible manner, which is that, you see, normally in digital circuits, you provide the input and you get the output. But in a P circuit, you know, built in this invertible manner, you could provide the output and it would give you all the different inputs that are consistent with that output. And this is very interesting because there are many problems which are relatively easy in the forward direction, but very hard in the reverse direction. For example, if you had a multiplier where you give 3 and 5 and you get 15, but if it is invertible, then you could give it 15 and it would give you the factors 3 and 5, which means it will work like a factorizer, which is a much more difficult problem. So this is what we have shown in, as I said, in a series of papers where you have addressed all kinds of different applications. And this is work in progress. So this list is continually being updated. And thank you for your interest.